So, dear ladies and gentlemen, it's my pleasure to introduce Professor John Hare from the University of Southern California. He got his education in Belgium, France, and he got his PhD in the United States in electrical engineering. He held positions at the European Space Agency, at the Philips Research Labs, at the Max Planck Institute, and finally he now works at the University of Southern California in two departments. He has an appointment in the Department of Electrical Engineering and in the Department of Mathematics. At the University of Southern California, he is a member of the Center of Applied for Applied Mathematical Sciences, the Center for Quantum Information Sciences and Technology, and the Lockheed USC Center for Adiabatic Quantum Calculations. He held several visiting positions at various universities in Australia, Europe, and United Kingdom. He now holds a senior fellow position at the Cardiff University, and he is a life fellow of the IEEE. I have met Professor John Hare at the University of Southern California. We have worked together on a project about information assurance. It was a large project sponsored by the DARPA, which is actually responsible for creating the internet originally. It was several departments were involved. It was really a large project, and we worked together several years. And then after some time, we have realized we have actually one more thing in common other than research, and it is we have realized we have one common friend, and that's the first speaker in the series which we are at right now, Professor Jean-Luc Godio, who was the first speaker in the series. He is actually a great friend of Professor John Hare, and he is a great friend of mine. And all three of us, we are avid pilots. We fly together. So that's actually the history which joins us together. So now I give you Professor John Hare. He's going to be talking about, the adiabatic quantum calculations.
Well, thank you very much. I hope that the volume is okay. If somehow the volume needs to be adjusted, feel free to raise your hand and interrupt me. Well, thank you very much, Rudy, for the introduction. And Rudy said it correctly that I would like to talk about quantum adiabatic computation. But I would like to give it a mathematical pitch, because there is a trend that disturbs me a little bit in engineering. Now, I'm talking about the US, I'm not so sure it's the same in Europe, but there is really a, how am I going to put it, some kind of a disbelief in mathematics. Somehow there is the feeling that we have so much computational tool that analytical investigation is no longer necessary, and I'm going to try to prove you the converse. Okay, let us just try to get to the heart of the subject. Let me see, I have to get used to this. Okay, this is a little bit of plan of action. I'm going to see there is a lot of thing that we need to cover, but you see the recurring theme, the mathematics is telling us something. You see, that's a little bit the recurring theme. I would like to come back to really analytical investigation to clarify some engineering problems. I hope I'm going to do it right. Okay, here is a very, very general introduction to quantum adiabatic computation. Now, even from a folklore point of view, there are lots of things that you could say about adiabatic quantum computation. Now, if you go to Wikipedia, you're already going to perceive that it's kind of a controversial issue, because Wikipedia is saying that this article has multiple issues that the that some of the sources of the article might not be reliable. The neutrality of this article is disputed. All kinds of problems. Now, some of these problems are valid scientific, academic, scholarly discussion. Unfortunately, not other discussion are a little bit straying outside the stream of science and are getting into politics and business. I'm going to talk about that. Okay, first of all, what is quantum adiabatic computation? Well, it's based on the tunneling principle in quantum physics, and the idea is the following. You have a potential barrier there, you see this, and then you have an incoming wave, traveling wave. And the wave is specified by what is called the wave function in quantum physics. The wave function is essentially oscillatory, and somehow the margin is the top height of this wave function, that's the probability of presence of the particle. Okay, so what is happening really is that if you look at the particle coming to the barrier with an energy lower than the top of the barrier, classical physics would say no, 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 you cannot do that. Quantum physics says the other way. Yes, somehow the particle can tunnel through the barrier. Of course, you're going to have reduced probability, but still a non-zero probability. That's a tunneling problem. How do you prove the tunneling problem? Well, you just have to write Schrödinger equation with that barrier potential. You need a little bit of block function and partial differential equation solution. Eventually, you're going to get it. Okay. Now, how is this applied to quantum computation? Here I have been trying to explain the principle of quantum computation. Now, the whole controversy really is quantum computation versus simulated annealing. Okay, here is a little bit of an idea of what simulated annealing is. From a mathematical point of view, what you have to find is the minimum of a function. From the physical point of view, somehow this function is the energy landscape of a quantum system or even a classical system, if you want. Sometimes the landscape is very complicated. I try to make it a little bit easy here. But if the landscape is complicated, it's very difficult to find the minimum, especially if you have multiple minimums. Sometimes the minimum might not be differentiable, other problem. So simulated annealing, what does it do really? You see, if you look at the problem as having the ball in the minimum of the potential, what you could do is kind of thermally activate the whole thing, and then you let the ball fall, and the ball is going to fall somehow, maybe not the global minimum, but some minimum, and then you wait, things to cool, exactly like you would do in physical metallurgy, and then you would have another little kick, okay, and then cool again, and eventually with a non-zero probability, you are going to reach the global minimum. So that's simulated annealing. Very efficient procedure. Quantum annealing or quantum adiabatic computation, when you see you are not quite at the minimum, the idea is to force the particle or the quantum system to tunnel through the barrier. And if you are tunneling through all of the barrier, eventually you are going to get to the minimum. Another illustration is in here. This is a very special landscape, energy landscape. You think about a particle that is just going down this potential slope there, hitting the barrier there. Well, somehow classically you would be stuck there, but probabilistic in quantum you have a possibility to tunnel through the barrier, whereas a classical thermal hopping would require you to start with an energy that is higher than the top of the barrier. We are going to come to this example. Okay, lots of other things going on there. I draw your attention on that thing there. You see that thing? That's called a swallowtail. It's kind of a piece of mathematics, a piece of differential topology. Oh my God, differential topology, one of the nastiest pieces of mathematics, I agree. Because you have seen some of the very top mathematicians of all times working in differential topology. And that is revealing a lot of things, really, a lot of things. It has something to do with the tunneling I'm going to show you. So somehow swallowtails are trying to tell us something about tunneling. I'll try to explain this. But for a fun exercise, if you want to get a visual idea of what the tunneling is, you see this ellipse there? Assume that you put explosive charges on the interior of that ellipse and that you look at the wavefront. initially the wavefront is going to be a smooth curve close to the where the charges were, but as the explosion started getting more and more inside, you are going to develop singularities, and that singularity can be shown to be a swallowtail. Maybe you see a little bit the difficulty in the plutonium bomb to model the charge, so that you see they had to deal with all of these singularities. But yeah, I don't want to talk too loudly about this because maybe the National Security Agency. Okay, let us keep on going. Here is a little bit of an idea of the mathematics that is going to come up. The colors are a little bit different to what I have done, but anyway, I'll try to go over this. And again, you see in here the swallowtail, which is really a mathematical object telling us a lot of things. Okay, how does that appear? So what you could think in here, you could think that you have two matrices, symmetric matrices H0 and H1. Okay, I'm saying mathematically this would be two symmetric matrices as far as quantum is concerned. This would be the Hamiltonian of one system, this would be the Hamiltonian of another quantum system. Now, somehow, if you come back to this picture, this should be the minimum of the H1, that should be the minimum of the H0. Okay, and here is, so somehow, one of the things really in quantum adiabatic computation is that there is that concept of moving from the minimum eigenvalue, the minimum energy of that Hamiltonian to that minimum. It's a continuation procedure somehow. Somehow the idea is that H1, it's a huge matrix, very complicated to compute its eigenvalue. Now huge, I'm talking about maybe a million by a million, and you have to figure out the eigenvalues of that. That might be extremely difficult. H0 is again a huge matrix, but maybe a piece of cake to compute the minimum eigenvalue. And then the continuation procedure, and actually quantum adiabatic is a continuation procedure. You start from that easy problem, you homotopy to the problem that you are going to try to solve. And then in that process, you could draw the plots of the eigenvalues of that homotopy between H0 and H1. Here is a plot. Here is another plot, which is coming from a real quantum system, the D wave. And then you see something, ash. You see the two curves there, the minimum energy one that you should track, that is getting dangerously close to the first excited one. So the danger in there is that the continuation might derail, and you might want to go from the blue curve to the yellow curve, and then you come up with the wrong solution at the end. This is called the gap problem. Okay, then you could say, hey, wait a minute, where is the swallowtail there? Well, here is the catch. It turns out, now this is my own way to massage continuation method and quantum adiabatic computation, it turns out that there is a matrix, there it is, this matrix is complex, not necessarily self-adjoint, and I'm just combining the initial matrix, the final matrix, and I'm adding the square root of negative one. I'm using the physicist notation because every time I'm using the G notation for the square root of minus one, I see the physicist really frowning. Anyway, and somehow the idea is that this single matrix represents all matrices along the homotopy there. Okay, then here is the trick really, and I'll explain this. There is the concept of the numerical range. Very deep concept really. What is the numerical range? Well, here it is. What you do in the numerical range is that you look at the value taken by the quadratic form associated with H when Z runs into the sphere, and that gives you a template somewhere. For the time being, just think about the blue part of the template. Forget about the yellow part, I'm coming to this. the numerical range is a very fundamental, it's a very deep problem. Maybe you could say, okay, z star hz, the set of value of z star hz when z is running in the sphere, so what, big deal? Well, the way I like to tell my student is that you can figure out how deep a problem is by looking at the mathematician who worked on that problem. Well, there is the so-called Toeplitz Hausdorff. Toeplitz, of course, I don't have to tell you who Toeplitz is. But Toeplitz and Hausdorff prove that this numerical range is convex and compact. Okay, convex, you see that thing. Okay, that's one thing. Somehow I have a very funny way to deal with the quantum adiabatic computation, and I'll explain this. Somehow the boundary there, the blue curve, that's the minimum energy level. It's a representation. I'm going to explain exactly the correspondence between these two graphs. Okay, and then what is going on? Just to be easy, do the following experiment. Try to sample the sphere uniformly. I know it's not that that easy. And then try to do a numerical mapping, and you're going to see the points, the dots, that are concentrating along a highly singular curve there inside the template. And somehow that highly singular curve has the swallowtails, the mathematics that is telling us a lot of things, and somehow that yellow curve there is the first excited level. So somehow the gap problem, when the minimum energy and the first excited level are getting close together, it's kind of the distance between the blue curve and the yellow curve there. And you have to look at the minimum distance over the whole curve. Well, you begin to see that the minimum is happening at the swallowtail. Aha! So that somehow the swallowtail, that differential topological concept, is telling us that the gap, really, that area where the energy difference is getting minimum, is happening at the swallowtail. Bingo, lots of difficulties to compute this. Anyway, that's just a bit of an idea. Okay, I think, okay, just a quick thing. The numerical range, it's a very old, very traditional problem, and somehow, maybe I'm preaching to my choir in here, is the control people who kind of resuscitated that concept and brought it to the 20th century, showing that it has a lot of interpretation in control. Okay, I just don't want to spend too much time on this. Okay, here is a menagerie or a zoology of numerical range and plots of eigenvalues as you homotopy between one symmetric matrix and another. And then you see repeatedly that swallowtail happening all over the place. It's there. And then somehow what you see is this anti-crossing phenomena. You just do that exercise. You have two matrices, H0 and H1. You homotopy from H0 to H1. You look at the eigenvalues, and then the eigenvalue never seems to be crossing. They seem to be repelling each other. You see that thing. That's called the anti-crossing problem. And that problem, what in the world is going on there? That was already haunting von Neumann. And it's by looking at this problem of the anti-crossing that von Neumann, actually back in the 1940s, came up with the idea of quantum adiabatic computation. Now, there are lots of issues going on in here. And I don't want to go through the detail. What you might try to, yeah, I'm never getting used to this system. What you might try to do is to look at, you see, a generalized numerical range. And then there are lots of problems with convexity. And then when you have a three or four parameter family when you have symmetric matrices parameterized by three or four or five parameters, then could you have the exact crossing of the eigenvalue? That's what von Neumann was working on. And von Neumann solved this problem. Let me just skip this. These are all kind of mathematical subtleties. I resolved all of these mathematical subtleties in these two papers. You see, what I try to tell my student, don't fool around with mathematics. mathematics can be extremely rewarding if, given a small detail that does not quite fit, if you investigate it, maybe that's going to be a PhD dissertation. But I'm telling my students, never, never brush a mathematical subtlety that bothers you under the rug, because then mathematics can be very nasty and that the next term mathematics is going to bite you very hard. No complacency in mathematics, like no complacency in flight. When something doesn't look right with the aircraft, just don't fly. Okay. Okay. So, the adiabatic theorem of von Neumann. Here we go. What is von Neumann doing then? He's saying, okay, if I have two matrices, I'm homotoping between the two matrices, there is that anti-crossing. How about three matrices? Some kind of homotoping between three matrices. Am I going to have exact crossing? Not yet, said von Neumann. However, he said, if you have three parameters, three independent parameters, then you could have exact crossing. That's what von Neumann is doing in here. Okay? Maybe not quite the adiabatic theorem, but it's coming from, you see, his point. It's written in German, but here it is. He's talking about the crossing of the eigenvalues. And then he's saying you need at least three independent parameters to have an exact crossing. Because in the homotopy there, of course, you might think that there are two parameters, a coefficient of zero, coefficient of H1, but you can normalize them so that you actually have one parameter. Okay, but that is getting very interesting in here. Okay, look in here, look in here. This is already the adiabatic theorem. But what Neumann is saying in here, he's saying essentially the following. You are, you see, you have that x parameter there, which is taking you from an original problem to a final problem. And somehow he wanted to follow the eigenvectors, really. But you have to be careful, because if you simulate a Schrödinger equation, even if you do it slowly, you might somehow, if you start Schrödinger equation with an eigenvector, the eigenvector of the minimum solution, integrate Schrödinger equation, well, maybe sooner or later the solution is no longer going to be an eigenvector, but the solution could be an eigenvector if you are going slow enough. And that's what von Neumann is doing in here. He's looking at the ground level, the minimum energy curve, the next energy curve, and he's looking at this gap in here. And then he's saying that if you run Schrödinger equation from x is equal to 0 to x is equal to infinity or 1 or whatever, really, he's saying that this is the way you have to slow down the process to remain adiabatic, so that the remaining adiabatic, I mean that the solution to the Schrödinger equation, you start with an eigenvector, it has to remain an eigenvector, so that you go from the minimum eigenvector to the minimum eigenvector of the other process. Okay, and he's calling this in German the Dauer der Vorbeigehens, which means the time to grow to go through the passage. Okay, but then it's even more astonishing in here. Then he's saying, okay, so far x was just a mathematical parameter, but he said if we could build a mechanical machine that does that process, we could solve the problem of the minimum energy level of a complicated quantum system, provided we slow down enough, blah, blah, blah. Here is the adiabatic theorem of von Neumann. He had it all already. Well, the way my attention was drawn to that paper of von Neumann, I had proved, you see, that three parameters necessary to have exact crossing. It was not an easy proof. I was very proud of that. And then somebody drew my attention to that paper of von Neumann. Actually, I was beaten in by von Neumann, but I took it philosophically. There's nothing wrong at being beaten in by von Neumann. Okay, now, here we go. Von Neumann. Here I would like to bring my own contribution, because if you look at the ground level in here and the first excited level, you see the gap there, that blue thing is kind of smooth. You go smoothly through the gap. You don't have many problems. I don't want to criticize von Neumann, but there are cases where the gap is closing extremely fast. And that's where the swallowtail is getting involved. Now, it turns out that when von Neumann wrote that article, somehow we did not yet have a very good theory of differential topology, so von Neumann could not have figured it out. Okay, let us keep on going, because I'd like to, again, talk a bit about the modern view, well, maybe rephrase the adiabatic theorem a little bit more carefully. Okay, so, many problems, as I was saying, boil down to computation of the ground level of a quantum system, H1. Okay, and what you want to do is the eigenvector of H1 corresponding to the minimum eigenvalue. Okay, and this is a wave function, the terminal wave function. Okay, so that might be extremely difficult. So what we do, we start with an easy quantum system, piece of cake to compute the ground level, the minimum eigenvector of that H0 Hamiltonian, and then the continuation when you go from the original to the terminal problem, that's really the specific feature of adiabatic quantum computation. You just go from the initial to the terminal, from H0 to H1, using the Schrödinger equation. So what you do, the initial condition to the Schrödinger equation is that eigenvector, there we go. Here is the Hamiltonian going homotopically from H0 to H1. Okay, and then you hope that the terminal condition of the integration of the Schrödinger equation is the minimum eigenvector of H1. So somehow the idea is that you start Schrödinger equation with an eigenvector, you want it to remain an eigenvector. Okay, now here is somehow the so-called, you are never going to have it exactly. What you can expect is that the overlap between the terminal solution of Schrödinger equation, what you want is greater than the tolerance. And if you want to achieve that tolerance, here is the criteria. This is called the Fock-Adiabatic theorem because you can fool that criteria under some condition. And there we go. You really need to integrate slowly. And somehow how slow you have to integrate is related to that gap there. And that gap sometimes could really close on you really, really, really fast if you have the swallowtail. Okay. Okay, here I'm getting a little bit more into the details of the numerical range approach to quantum adiabatic computation. So, a picture is worth a thousand words. So, here we go. I'm starting with H0. That's the easy problem. That's a difficult problem. And you see, I'm going from H0 to H1 trigonometrically. There we go. But then I'm returning back to H0. So I'm doing it a little bit in a funny way that is not quite the way you do it in quantum adiabatic computation for many reasons. Because usually in quantum adiabatic computation, you just take a straight homotopy from H0 to H1. Now, the reason why I'm doing it this way, it is just because I can link it to the numerical range. And the reason why I'm closing the loop, because I'm going to develop homotopy invariant. That's a little bit the idea. Okay, so a little bit of mathematics here. So somehow what's happening is that the time, the homotopy parameter is that angle theta there. There we go. And you see, you have to look at wave function. The wave function, by definition, is normalized to one, so you assume that it's on a sphere. But somehow, one of the mysteries of quantum mechanics is that you can never find a global phase factor. You can only find difference of phase among the components. So you have to quotient by the global phase factor, which is equivalent to quotienting out by S1, and then you get the complex projective space. But anyway, the complex projective space, what it is a unit sphere where you don't care about the global phase factor period. You can think it this way. So that the energy function, there it is. This is the, I'm calling this H theta, that's the Hamiltonian between the initial and the final one. And see, these are the Dirac notation, but this is the quadratic form associated with that matrix. Okay, Here is the, you see, this is a little bit to justify that what I'm doing is close to what is done. This is usually what is done, and closing the loop in an affine way would be this one. And then I'm kind of explaining that since I'm going to develop homotopy invariant, topological invariant, that are telling us some properties no matter up to some kind of deformation of the homotopy path. So you see, I can certainly say that the circular path and this Losange path are about the same from the point of view of topology, where I am not, where I'm trying to get properties independent of the exact path, but more depending on the structure of the problem. Okay. Here is really a little bit the whole issue. And again, I'm skipping the mathematical detail. Okay, here is the sphere, the unit sphere of the wave functions. And probably, let us just draw that line, and let us plot on that line the eigenvalue somewhere at the theta step of the homotopy. There it is. And then you have a certain point, which is an eigenvector actually, mapping to the eigenvalues. Okay, that f theta, that's like this quadratic function there. There we go. Okay, and then you have another eigenvector, the second eigenvector mapping to the second eigenvalue. These are eigenvectors. Okay, it turns out that these eigenvectors are critical values. What are critical values? Well, when you have a function, you can compute partial derivatives. And you know, when the partial derivative cancel, it's good news, bad news. It's good news because you have a minimum, a global minimum, a local minimum. It's bad news because the inverse function theorem doesn't work really around those points. And somehow when you have a multiple function like that, you have to look at the Jacobian, you have to argue the rank of the Jacobian, and if the rank of the Jacobian drops, good news, you have some kind of a minimum or so. Bad news is that if the rank of the Jacobian drops too low, you cannot invert the function. Okay, so that's the reason why these are called singular critical values. Okay, then I'm going to break that easy function, the function going from an eigenvector to the eigenvalue easy enough. I'm going to break it into this way. I'm first of all going to go to the template using that matrix, and then I'm going to project back on the line, and somehow these two things are commute. Okay, here is the deal really. Now, if you look at this template, you agree that the extreme eigenvalues are related to this boundary here. But somehow the idea is that what really corresponds in the template to the other eigenvalue, these are this additional curve there, critical value curves. Okay, so what are these critical value curves? What you have to do really is to compute the Jacobian there, see where that Jacobian has a dropping rank. You have some points, and then you map those points to the template, and you get those curves. But the basic idea is the following. You have the template, you have the boundary, you project the boundary, and you are getting the extreme eigenvalues. You have other curves with swallow tails, you project them, and you get the other eigenvalue. So somehow the gap is in here, you see? So the gap is there. But you see somehow that theta line has to rotate, and then you see there's going to be a position like you project like this, where you would have the gap, you would have a small distance between the boundary and that internal curve. That would be the gap, the adiabatic gap, and it's happening along the swallowtail. Ha ha. Okay. So this is really a summary of the whole mathematical issue. I repeat, the eigenvalues, the pre-image point of the eigenvalues are eigenvectors. These eigenvectors are critical points. Okay, and somehow that easy map is broken into two maps, the maps that goes to the template and the maps that projects. Okay, and the two maps commute. And if you just draw the line perpendicular to that point, you're going to hit a tangent, that line is going to be tangent to the tappet. So you see, you could play with envelopes and everything and curve theory. And somehow, if you raise this perpendicular from that point, you are getting a critical value curve. Okay. All right, so you understand now that the template is some kind of a very interesting representation of what is going on really with the gap. Okay, but maybe it's going to come a little bit clear. Okay, here we go. I'm getting more into adiabatic quantum computation now. I see a little bit of a mistake in here, but here is a little bit the idea. This is a quadratic unconstrained binary optimization problem, meaning that the free variable sp and sq are taking the value plus or minus one. And you have a quadratic part and you have a linear part. And then if you JPQ there is kind of complicated, if the capital N there is very large, you're gonna have a very, very hard time to find that minimum, because it's a binary optimization problem. It's not like a matter of computing the partial of this function relative to SP and SQ and set it to zero. Okay, this is where computer science is kicking in, all kinds of issues related to NP completeness, NP hardness, etc. Okay, so here there is a little bit of a typo, I apologize for this, but this should be a SQ there. Okay, so the way you do it, you define an easy H0, just a linear function of those binary variable, piece of cake to compute the minimum, you know how to do that. They all have the same sign, basically. That's a complicated problem. And somehow, what you could do is simulate an annealing, trying to go from this solution to that one. Okay, we are going to do it quantum mechanically. So, you see the problem, the way it is set up. So what you could think is that you have four vertices. If you have four variables, just an easy way, that vertex could take value plus or minus one, okay? And then you have an edge, and you define the strength of that edge to be the coefficient of S1, S2 there, okay? Kind of a graph representation. Okay, here, and then you have that coupling matrix telling you the way the graph is coupled. Of course, the graph is coming from the JPQ there, and I have arranged the JPQ to be a ring, because I personally like rings, because quantum rings, these are basically prototype of quantum routers. Anyway, now look, when you have, for example, a situation like this that may or may not be optimal, you might be somewhere in the homotopy. You map this as follows. You see, S1 is becoming this vector because it's plus one. S2 is becoming this vector because it's plus one. S3 is getting minus one. S3 is minus one, is becoming this vector, etc. And then you take the tensor product. And this is defining you a vector. I should normalize it. Okay, there it is. This is a quantum state. Okay, the quantum state of what system I'm going to come to this. And somehow that tricky quadratic term is becoming like this. So you see, it's becoming, these are the Pauli operators. So it's becoming, like I said before, ZHZ. It's becoming what we had before. Okay, so I have already made part of the quantum transition here, but I would like to know what the quantum transition is right here. Next slide. There we go. So it's becoming a system of four spins. Okay, there it is. I put all of the spins up. Now this H is becoming the coupling strength. Okay, because classically you would think that this spin, that's a magnetic moment, is propagating a magnetic field, and then when you have a magnetic field in a spin, that creates an energy, that's a bit the J12. And then if you do like what I did before, the mapping from quadratic boundary optimization to energy of spin system, you find that you are back to the H0H1, and all of the matrices involved are the Pauli operators. I'm just skipping this. And this problem is easy to solve, that one is difficult. And what you want to do now, as von Neumann is saying, let us build a mechanical machine that takes us from this quantum state to that one, and this is done by the D-wave computer. There it is, the D-wave chip. What is the D-wave computer? It's a very special architecture called the Kimmel architecture. You see, you have this K44 grab interconnected in some way, and somehow there is a very non-trivial problem. I'm going to come back to this, is that this is your problem graph. The problem graph that is given by those coefficient of the quadratic term. And you have to map this to the architecture graph. Not an easy problem. It's called the embedding problem. But anyway, skipping this, it turns out that there is that Canadian company that bit the bullet that said, okay, let us build the damn machine that von Neumann was dreaming about. And I did it with quite a lot of technological difficulties. So that machine essentially is simulating all of these spins, simulating the magnetic field that is interacting with that spin. There it is, simulating the coupling strand. I'm just keeping the technological details that are absolutely astonishing. This is the chief executive officer of that company. That gives you a little bit of an example of how the spin is materialized using superconducting technology and Joseph Singh junction. Okay, all right, and of course, you see, when you have the two quantum states getting close together, there is a so-called quantum noise that exists even at 0 degree Kelvin, and the quantum noise could have you jump from the ground state to an excited state. So you want to cool the computer, and that's where really things are astonishing. I don't know how they did it, but they managed to cool it to a temperature which is 100 of the temperature of the universe. The temperature of the universe is 3 degree Kelvin. You know, the antenna experiment at Bell Labs that discovered the cosmic background radiation by looking at the spectrum of the noise, it was determined that it's 3 degree Kelvin. This computer is cooled to 30 millikelvin. And I'm glad to tell my visitor to my university, look, this is the coolest place in the universe. Anyway, okay, all right, good. So let me look at one of those Ising chain, and I'm setting up that Ising chain to be representative of the Glover search, is to search like a black ball in a jar when you have a series of black balls and white ball. Anyway, I'm skipping the detail, but what's happening is that you can map this to an adiabatic problem. There we go. You can map it to the adiabatic problem, and it's something like this, what you get for the H0 and the H1. And then what I'm doing is that I'm building the matrix H0 plus IH1. And I was telling you that somehow the template there is telling you the whole story about the gap. Okay, so what I did is that I built that H0 plus IH1 and I looked at the template and it looks like this. This is a bad template. It's a so-called numerically unstable template. It's a so-called non-generic template. For the reason that generically the numerical range, as envisioned by Toeplitz already, had a smooth boundary, compact, convex, blah, blah, blah. And this one is certainly not smooth, because you see that thing there, that's bad news. It already means that this template is topologically unstable. It means that it's a non-generic situation that is going to be shattered by data perturbation. And again, that line segment, it is also bad news. use. It is telling you that there is some non-generosity. So you have lots of non-generosity, and if you have looked at the theory of numerical range, you see this is really bad. And it turns out that this is the basic template of an Ising chain, the Ising chain, which is really the technology of quantum adiabatic computation. No, you see, it doesn't quite match with the picture that I gave you, but somehow this is the ground level. Okay, this is the ground level, and this is the first excited level, and somehow the gap is here. Huge gap. You would say, wow, great, that's it, it's all solved. Something that is haunting the designer of the quantum adiabatic computer are uncertainties. All of these spins, can you accurately program the coupling? Can you actually program the magnetic field that interact with the spins? It's haunting them. And they keep very quiet about that. Very, very quiet. I've been trying to get some more information from them because I have a little bit of a suspicion, but then I received some threat that I'm not supposed to do reverse engineering, blah, blah, blah. But anyway, let us do the following exercise. Let us deliberately perturb this data and see the result. Kaboom. The blue is what everybody believes, what the D-wave believes. The red is my warning that this numerical range is so much topologically unstable. Look at what a disaster. The blue from the red, what a disaster. And, the swallowtails there. Then they appear. The problem is that the swallowtails are topologically stable. These are generic phenomena. We had giant in mathematics like Vladimir Arnold who proved that. Okay? That did not appear in the blue one, because the blue one was in the ideal situation, a small perturbation of becoming generic, and boom, you see the swallowtails. But look at sheer disaster strikes in here. Look at the small gap in here. You see that swallowtail there nearly crashing on the boundary. So you believe that you are doing great, because you believe that this is the gap. But after a small perturbation, the gap is nearly closing on you. This is what the mathematics is telling us. Swallowtail is telling us, be careful, be careful. The mathematics is telling us here that the basic Ising chain formulation of quantum adiabatic computation is topologically unstable. So we have to be very, very careful. And this is Swallowtail telling you. So that's one of the things that mathematics is telling us in this problem. Okay, I don't want to go through the proof of this. It's in here. Let me just skip it. What I want to say is that this is the so-called gap. You see the way it scales, and from there you could figure out the way you have to slow down the scaling of the slowing down and skipping the details. Okay, so I think I convinced you that swallowtails have something to do. Let us look at swallowtails from a topological point of view a little bit. What is going on there? Okay, and again, I'm trying to be quick about this. So you see in here two situations. The ground level, the first excited level, and here you might already say, just be careful, you have the swallowtail getting a little bit close. In here the situation is a little bit more dangerous, you see the swallowtail is nearly crashing on the boundary there. Okay, what is really the swallowtail? The swallowtail is a combination of two cusps, singularities like this. Now, what you have to do is to make sure that you really have a cusp singularity, something like this, and not a corner or the five half cusps. Okay, you need some topology to sort this out, but it can be sorted, and you can prove that what's happening are three half cusps. Okay, and somehow the characterization of these cusps, these boundary point of the swallowtail is this. You have to look at this at the first excited eigenvalue, its second derivative, and at the cusp that should equal to zero. And this is the new topologically invariant that I have to propose, and I'll show you some example of that. So what's happening is that you have a cusponder satisfying that condition, a cusponder satisfying this condition, and then you have that kind of widow to connect the two cusps. You see, there is a bit of a puzzle. You might say, why is the boundary smooth? And why is that other curve singular in general? Let me just give you a little bit of the feeling of how that goes. The invariant, you can prove that it's equal to that thing. And then you see if lambda k is the maximum eigenvalue, this is always positive definite, so that never cancels. But if somehow that eigenvalue is the middle of other eigenvalue, you see that thing is, that pseudo-inverse is vanishing, and then you have singularity. That's a little bit the story. Anyway, I don't want to go too much through the mathematics that we see. This is more like knot theory, differential topology. Again, let me just skip this because it's going to take us much farther. Now, you see, this is the curve that I have traditionally shown. But you could have more complicated curve, and then what you would like to have is a topological classification of these curves. The topological classification, let me just give you the final result, because in here we are getting, just to tell you that to figure out what is going on inside that template, what is going on within those singular curve, closely related to the gap phenomenon in Javatic complex, it takes quite a lot of mathematics. Let me just give you the taste of it by showing you the kind of topology involved. This is differential topology, not theory. I'm just skipping the detail. This is the classification of Arnold, and we are somehow in here. It would take me too long to get to the detail of this. This is a little bit of a fun interpretation of the swallowtail in terms of of implosion. See, you have a curve, you have the wavefront there, and if somehow the radius of curvature, the radius of these circle is less than the inverse of the curvature, somehow you don't have singularity. But if you allow the wavefront to propagate, to propagate more and more, you begin to see the swallowtail there. That's kind of the fun thing. Then you kind of see the swallow. Anyway, it's one of those fun interpretations that is helping students get the concept. So swallowtail are related to the gap, but we know that fundamentally quantum adiabatic computation is a tunneling issue. Okay, and my point is that swallowtails are also saying something about tunneling. So Mark Tegmark, which is kind of a bit of a weird professor of physics at MIT, said that anything that exists mathematically exists physically. The swallowtail, you might say, it's a beautiful piece of mathematics. It exists in physics, is the tunneling. Anyway, that's just to spice up the talk a little bit. Okay, so I'm going to do the following experiment, which is based on this paper of my colleague Ben Reichardt. Okay, and essentially he's looking at the following energy landscape. The Hamming weight is the number of spin up, spin that are excited. Okay, that would be the Hamming weight Hamiltonian, and then he's putting a barrier on top of it. Okay. And then he's looking at quantum adiabatic computation. He's putting the initial state there, and then he's trying to figure out what is happening as you are trying to get through the barrier. There are many parameters I could play with. I could play with the width of the barrier, but more importantly, I would like to play with the position of the barrier along that energy there. Okay? All right. So in here, the ground level, you see the Hamming weight there, all spins are down, the Hamming weight is zero, and I am setting up the Hamiltonian so that it is zero at zero Hamming weight. Okay? Anyway, so this is kind of a little bit of a complicated, well, the problem is that if you want to realize this with spin, you need multi-body, but I'm skipping the details, it's a mathematical exercise. Okay, so let us first of all forget all about the barrier. Have a beautiful energy landscape, there it is. And then you understand that it's a piece of cake for the adiabatic quantum computer to go down the slope and get to the minimum. And then the fact that it's a piece of cake, you see it from the template that is very nice, very smooth. The internal curve is even very smooth. These are the energy level. You see the gap is constant. And this is the topological invariant, the lambda plus lambda double prime, that never equals zero. So everything is beautiful there. When you put a barrier, things are getting more complicated. Oops. You see a single barrier, it's already creating quite a lot of disruption. Before I had this, now the tunneling, aha. You see, you begin to see swallowtails. Maybe they are still far from the external boundary. And then you see the topological invariant there is getting to zero there. You see that curve there. And that zero crossing is related to these points, to these cusp points. And these are the eigenvalues of H0 plus H1. And if you look at the energy, plots, well, okay, you see a little bit of a gap there, but it's nothing very serious. No, I'm increasing the barrier, and things are getting nastier. You see, the more I'm increasing the barrier, the more things are getting nasty. Okay, let us do it again. Piece of cake. Already some problem because there is a barrier there, and I'm increasing the height of the barrier, making it more and more difficult for the adiabatic computer to tunnel through that barrier. And then you begin to see more and more of these swallow tails getting closer and closer to the ground state. There it is. You see the invariant is getting zero, meaning danger. And then you see this. You see the gap there, you see the gap is really closing because the swallowtails are getting close to the boundary there. Okay, and I'm increasing and things are getting worse and worse. You see definitely you begin to see a steep gap there, that things are really closing very fast. So what is happening is that along the homotopy, you have the energy, you come a bit here, and then you end up somewhere there along the homotopy, and then in the final rush to the minimum, you have to tunnel through the barrier, and the difficulty is given by those swallowtails close to the boundary by that gap closing there. Okay, all right. Okay, now let us play a little bit with the position of the barrier. You see here, I definitely put the barrier very, very close to the ground level, saying that, okay, you see the algorithm, the adiabatic algorithm is getting, is decreasing in energy, is coming to there, and if the barrier is close to zero, it's very likely that the process is not going to do this, but that is going to have to go this way. Now let me move the barrier upstairs like this, and then what's happening is that the homotopy is kind of coming like this and avoiding the barrier, and then you see it, no more swallowtails because you don't have to tunnel to the barrier anymore. Okay, so the swallowtail is telling us something about tunneling in here. Okay. Okay, now you could play with plots at length, and it's very easy to do that. It's very easy to give that to a student. Students are overwhelmed. Now, the difficulty for the professor is when the student is coming with these beautiful plots and are very good at that, is for me to interpret what's happening in here. Anyway, just as a peripheral remark, I'd like to show you something in here. Let me see, it doesn't come, there's a problem with the color, I don't think it's coming out very clearly, but I think it doesn't come as clear as I was expecting this. Let me just skip this one. Let me just try to comment on it. Okay, you see the swallowtail there getting close, and the fact that you have cut should give you zero invariant. This is the lambda plus lambda double prime. You see zero, it's crossing there, indicative. And here you begin to see what I call a steep gap, and then you begin to see two inflection points. An inflection point for the first excited level, meaning that it goes like this, and an inflection point because these are the lambda double primes, and the lambda double primes is equal to zero. These are the inflection points. So this is really an idea of a very steep gap where you have inflection points in the ground level and inflection point in the first excited level, and you see it very well. Usually, when the invariant is coming out like this, this is bad news, meaning that you are really, really close to derail in your adiabatic ground. Okay, let me see. I think this would take me a little. Okay. Let me just quickly go over this because we are really running out of time. I would like to give due credit to simulate annealing it here. You see, when the boss of the D-Wave company came to see us, no matter how much he has been criticized, especially by people who have some vested interest in other companies, he was very candid. He was asking us, please give us some problems that we could test our machine on. And one of those problems is the solution of the interference problem in wireless networking. And I'd like to call this problem quantum wireless. You see, this is a wireless networking. These are the airlink, these are the packets. And somehow one of the ideas of wireless networking is to give a weight to the links, a weight related to the Q differential. Okay, here the weight is 2, there it's 1, there it's 2. And somehow that weight is telling you how badly you want to use that link. Okay, how badly you want to use it. The problem is that there is the interference problem, is that you would like to activate these two links because along these links the Q backlog is huge, so you would like to move packets this way because this is the same, but you cannot do that because you're going to have interference there. Okay, to make a long story short, you can solve that interference problem, namely what edge you have to activate to have maximum throughput. You can convert that into a quadratic binary optimization problem. I'm just skipping a lot of details. I just want to tell you that I would like to give due credit to simulated annealing. In here, here we go. The blue one is the simulated annealing. The red one is the brute force implementation of quantum adiabatic computation. The yellow one is when you put error correction in quantum adiabatic computation. And this is the time evolution of the wireless network, and this is the delay to transfer the packets from the source to the destination. You see, if you don't do error correction, really, quantum adiabatic computation doesn't look very good, really. But if you do error correction, then you are getting competitive with the quantum annealing. So just to tell you that you have to be careful. In this problem, if you look at the red curve versus the blue curve, quantum adiabatic computation does not come very nicely, really. Okay, but if you are careful, if you do what is called the gap enlargement, if you put error correction, then you are becoming competitive. Now my student is just telling me that he managed, after some more tweaking, he managed to beat the simulated annealing. So I have to be very honest in here. I have seen millions of problems. I have seen millions of results. I have seen many claims, some of them purely scientific, some of them not so much scientific when Wall Street is getting involved. And see, I believe the jury is still not there, really. There is definitely a subclass of system where quantum adiabatic computation is extremely competitive, even increasing the speed by a factor of 50. There are other problems where it does not come very nicely as this one. Just to give diligence to classical simulated annealing. Again, you see, this is unperturbed problem, no gap enlargement. We are doing the gap enlargement. There are still some problems, so you have to be very careful about the gap there, because this is like the brute force simulation of the interference problem in wireless problem, brute force on quantum adiabatic machine, not being careful, and then you see the gap is very small, you see that nasty swallowtail, you see that the invariance is getting zero, and if you correct it, you have all of these things disappearing. Let me see, I'll try to finish in 5 minutes to tell you something else. Okay, let us come back to this. I'm just skipping through this because, this is a so-called, this is the Kimmel architecture. This is the architecture of the quantum computer. So it's an architecture that is supposed to be universal as you possibly could. In the sense that many graph, problem graph, traveling salesman graph, should be embeddable in this architecture. Now that architecture was designed by Vicky Shaw, she's a computer scientist from New York, using a lot of intuition really. She had absolutely no way to gauge how optimal was this for embeddability, and she came up with that idea of putting together the K44 graph in a matrix and then connecting things this way. Okay, some graphs are embeddable, some other graphs are not embeddable. The problem is that checking whether, and that's one of the bottlenecks of quantum adiabatic computation. It turns out that to figure out whether a graph is embeddable is a very difficult problem. It's one of so-called NP-complete problem. Then somebody came up with a criterion saying if the tree width of the problem graph is smaller than the tree width of the architecture graph, you can do the embedding. Problem is that computing the tree width is again a disaster. Okay. All right. There comes differential topology. So what we figured out is that this is kind of something that has been going on for the last 10 years. And probably, Rudy, you remember that was my big contribution to the DARPA project we had on the curvature of graphs. You remember that? How much we discussed that with Duke Morgan, how much he grilled me on this. Okay, so what is the curvature of graph? Well, okay, very crudely speaking, you have a graph, a big graph, and you look at it from a distance. And then it could look like a sphere, the graph is positively curved, or it could look like a saddle, the graph is negatively curved. Okay, very, very crudely speaking. So there's that concept of graph curvature. There is the Gromov concept, there is the Gauss concept, but I'm going to use the Oliver Richard curvature concept. I don't have the time to go through this. It was devised by a young French mathematician, Yann Olivier. And what we found out is that there is a linear relationship between the tree width and the curvature. Okay, you see this? There we go. Now we need high tree width of the architecture to have good embeddability, so we need positive curvature. Okay. That's a little bit of contribution. We have partially proved some of these bounds in here. Okay, now the problem is that the only Fibonacci curve which is easy to compute is just a matter of linear programming. Okay, I was telling you now for the story, what's happening and that made the whole community a little bit upset is that Vicky Shaw must have burnt herself up looking at this graph embeddability. Then she decided to become a nun. Then everybody was upset, such a talent, going to a monastery somewhere in Vancouver. The latest I heard is that she quit the monastery and that she's back to academic life now. Anyway, here we go. Here we go. We plot the curvature versus the size of the array. We plot the curvature. The K44 is there.
Can you repeat it, please?
What I want to repeat is that...
What do you want to match?
What I would like to do in here is to plot the curvature of the Chimera architecture versus the size of the array. And the curves are color-coded, whether it's K44, K55, K88, etc. Look, the K44 is not the best one. Mathematics is telling us something else. Differential topology, curvature is telling us, be careful. The K44 was a good bet, actually, but you would do much better with the K88. Mathematics is telling us another thing. And I think I'm going to stop here. Maybe this slide says it all. Quantum adiabatic computing is a formidable problem. So many, many mathematics, physics, computer science problems that you can play with. And my point in here is that don't just run simulation. Try to understand the mathematics. The mathematics might be extremely difficult, but I could show you it has revealed a lot of things. And here it's revealing that the Chimera architecture of the D-Ray is not the best possible. And I think I'm going to stop sharing. Thank you very much for the attention.
So thank you, Professor Yonghere. And do we have any questions in the audience?
Yes, I noted that you were listening very carefully.
What is the definition of the Chimera architecture in general? So the graph you showed is...
Yeah, exactly.
That's the image of K44 is not scalable, so how do you scale it?
Yeah, the Chimera architecture is this one. That's it. No, this is the Chimera architecture. What you could play with is to have a bigger matrix in here. Okay, this is the very first D-Wave compute, and then went to a 16 by 16. And then you could play, as I was suggesting, from K44 go to K88. And that would be a graph where the embeddability might be easier. Okay?
So you are still in 2D mesh? So
it's a 2D mesh, yes.
Yeah. You can increase the degree of the complete bipartite graph.
Yes, and, that's it, yeah, that's it.
You speak only with powers of 2, so K4, K8, K16?
We did not the K16, we did the K88 computation. That one, the curvature is more positive than the K44. So the trim width is higher if you were taking K88 instead of K44 there.
And the relationship between the, so you said that one of the results you have made within that project is that there is a relationship between the curvature and the embeddability, basically the...
The embeddability, yes, there it is, yeah.
And I didn't understand how is it related to quantum gravity. So you proved by that simulation using adiabatic quantum computing that
this is just pure mathematics in here. This is graph theory, curvature theory. This is differential, this is geometric topology.
Okay.
This is purely mathematics, where the quantum adiabatic computation gets into the picture is when you have to embed the graph problem into the architecture problem. Okay, so there is an algorithm to do that, but it takes so much time. 10 times as much as the adiabatic computation itself. There are some shortcuts based on the tree width, but again, the tree width is difficult to compute. And my suggestion is just to look at the curvature to find out a better architecture.
Nice.
Again, here the mathematics is telling us something again. But you have to really spend a considerable amount of time going through all of the mathematics. The way I'm telling my students that sometimes the mathematics require quite a lot of investment but somehow the reward, the return from your investment can be dramatic.
I think I should tell Professor Jung-Harry that we have some people here who do the simulated annealing, and we have a whole row of people there who came from the School of Physics and Nuclear Engineering. Is it how you translate it? We just call it YAC, that's the short abbreviation.
Okay.
So it's the physics, mathematical physics, nuclear engineering. So there is a whole row of people here who actually understand
okay.
a lot of what you are saying.
Okay.
So maybe I'm going to thank you for chairing our first quantum computing session. Maybe we will start doing quantum computing. I see a whole row of people who may be interested.
Okay, all right.
Do we have any more questions?
Could you say something about the real D-wave machine, how it works? And I just didn't miss. So it's really a machine which was physically built?
Oh yes. By the D-wave company in Canada, yeah. You see, here it is. So somehow, you see when you have a graph, so somehow the spins in the D-wave machine, this is a superconducting loop.
Uh-huh.
You see this? And then you have a Josephson junction, which is switching between the spin up this way or the spin down that way. Now, you have to be a little bit careful because the way I crafted the chimera architecture is not really, not quite an accurate picture of what's going on. Because somehow a spin, it's that loop there, you see? And somehow the coupling is the intersection between the two loops. So that's why they opted for that chimera architecture, because it was implementable.
Oh, I see.
Okay, so that's a little bit the story, and you can program the coupling strength, which is that intersection of these two things. You can program the strength of that magnetic field in that spin. The big problem, the way I understand, is that they have some difficulties at programming accurately the coupling strength there, which is the JPQ. My suspicion is that there are some parasitic couplings. Like technically, you could only have, if you look, you see, I think that you have coupling at a distance, like multi-body coupling there. That's my suspicion, because that's kind of the only way I could think that some of the errors of the computer are coming about. Sorry, I'm reverse engineering it here.
So do I understand correctly that you have this machine?
Oh yes, we do, at ISI, yeah,
okay.
At ISI, yeah. We just upgraded to 1024 qubits. It's working. I have a student who has access to this machine, who can program it, and who has been running the simulation.
And that's the coolest place. And this is the coolest place.
Yes, unless an astrophysicist would disagree with me. By the way, you can visit that antenna in Bell Labs, where in the 1950s they could not remove a background noise. The three Bell Labs physicists or engineer, I don't remember exactly, Penzias was one of the names, they were struggling to try to remove a background noise. And I started thinking that maybe it was not because of the forestry or industrial electromagnetic pollution. They start thinking very seriously that it could have been something related to the universe. And at about the same time in Princeton, if I remember right, they had done some calculation on the Big Bang theory, the expansion of the universe, the Friedmann-Lemaître model, and they had come up with 3 degrees Kelvin And the Bell Labs people came up exactly with 2 degrees Kelvin, the way that figure is out. They looked at the background radiation, and then they matched that with the Planck curve, and they found out that the background radiation was the Planck curve at the 2 degrees Kelvin.
Actually, 2 years ago, we had a person who did it at the university giving a talk.
Oh, okay, wonderful, wonderful. Yeah. One of the 3 Bell Labs person?
Yeah.
Who was he? Penzias, maybe?
No, the other one.
And the other, yeah, don't be, Penzias is the only name that I can remember.
Yeah.
But you can still visit this this antenna.
He has shown exactly the same figure, and he's
exactly
he explained the whole story behind.
Yeah,
and
that's it.
How
yeah.
was it related to yeah. the yeah. To the Bell research? Actually.
Yeah, I've always had a little bit of taste for cosmology, and course, what is wonderful is that in quantum adiabatic we are back to some of the cosmological concepts, which makes it quite attractive to me.
So how big is the DWAF chip? It's really a small chip?
Let me show. Well, my first slide I had a picture. It's a pretty big machine, really, because the cooling is really taking yeah. so much space.
It's few millimeters.
There it is. You see, that's the box there. And let me see, that's about the height of a person there.
I see.
Actually, it's a little bit bigger than my height when I'm sitting next to it. It's about a box this size, about. And again, most of the place is taken by the cooling.
Cooling system. So you have upgraded to 1024?
Yes, we have the 1024 now, yes, we just upgraded.
So it's the biggest in the world now?
I believe it has been done for a while, and my student was just telling me that it should be up right now. The bill was paid by Lockheed, because Lockheed wanted to get in. Lockheed is the kind of company that wants really to be, how am I going to put it, the mover of quantum technology in the aerospace field. I could really feel that. I did not know exactly what they wanted, but they just want to be involved. Maybe file some patent before someone else filing the patent.
So the head of the company is really a big visionary.
Actually,
or completely crazy, maybe.
Yeah, actually, I think I do. Yeah,
no. Maybe that's because it's very cool if you go up.
Yeah.
The stratosphere is very cool. So.
Yeah. Well, still, I think it's just too hot, even outside space is too hot for quantum computation. But maybe it would be cheaper. To cool from 3 degrees Kelvin to 30 millikelvin than to do it on the face of the Earth.
So any questions from the guys there?